Hey everyone, welcome to the premiere episode of The New Trust Economy. I'm Tracy Hazard and I'm here with
Monica Prophet.
And Monica and I are super excited to be bringing you this new show. And we are really excited about bringing information on blockchain, cryptocurrency, all things in those regions that you guys have questions about.
Right? And not necessarily just like the really deep technical stuff about like hash graphs. I promise not to talk about hash graphs unless somebody else brings it up. How about that? I'll talk about like how it relates to normal people that want to just be a part of the economy as it grows. What's the newest thing that's happening in the real business world?
Exactly. Yeah, Monica, I love that because I don't know what that is. And I'm like, okay, now I have to go Google hash graphs. I know. But you know, this is the thing. It's like, I'm just going to tell the story about how I sort of got started here, and that'll give you an idea about whether or not this show is right for you. So I have been writing an ink column for 3 years. I'm about to start my fourth year writing it, and it's on innovation. So I'm always exploring new areas of innovation, whether it's VR, AR, AI, 3D printing, could be anything. And blockchain came along, and it intrigued me. And I had been kind of sitting on the sidelines watching it, but never writing about it, reading some things, but not moving.
I'm just going to stop you right there. Tracy, what was the first thing that you remember? Like, when was the first time that you heard blockchain and you were like, huh? Because it intrigued me is like, a lot of things intrigue me, but the first time I hear something that it actually sticks in my head and I go, oh, I want to know about that thing. What was that for you?
Yeah. So for me, I heard blockchain in conjunction with AI before I heard about it in conjunction with cryptocurrency.
Yep.
And so for me, that started to make sense. And so because you can have in an AI world, in an artificial intelligence world, to have your data, you know, needs to machine learn, but it also has to learn from disparate places. And so that's where a lot of blockchain is being utilized. And I thought, okay, this is really interesting. But then people would ask me, well, what's blockchain? And I'd be like, well, let me explain that. Yeah. And well, so I was I better be able to answer that because that's my job. So I started to look it up and what really started to intrigue me first, because my business and my background is in product design and development, is supply chain management. So that's actually what intrigued me before cryptocurrency or anything like that. And so, you know, I've been looking at that and saying, you know, there's a whole lack of trust in the supply chain model, and is this the answer? And so looking at it, I was like, wow, I could really see the applications. And that is kind of, I think, my gift about what I write about, is that my gift is saying there are applications here. Let's go find great stories and let me feature them so that you can have a clear understanding. So way back when I started a podcast on 3D printing called WTFFF, and that was almost 5 years ago. So we have like over 550 episodes on it. But what I saw was the same thing in blockchain and cryptocurrency. Is I saw the same model of what we were talking about back when we started that show, was that there was so much hype around it that people were missing out and were afraid to like even ask, like, what does this mean? And so there wasn't a lot of shows, there wasn't a lot of information out there that demystified this and sort of broke it down and said, how am I going to use this? How am I going to apply this in my business? And what am I going to do with it? And what are some really great companies that are doing really great things that are very applicable and I could model and understand? And so that was what I was seeking, and I didn't realize I was seeking it, but I was sort of looking at it. And a really great PR agent friend of mine pushed me and said, you have to come to this conference in Vegas called Chain Exchange. And I was like, you know, I love this. I'm really intrigued by this idea, but I'm so busy right now to like go to another conference and write, you know, and write a series of articles. I'm like, I'm just too busy. And then she said, if I could get you an interview with Steve Wozniak, Molly Bloom, Common, like, would you show up? And I was like, okay, I'm there.
Oh, in that case, yeah.
And then I found out that my good friend Adrian Ashley, who's developing a dating app called Lolly, was going to be there. And so I'm messaging her, and that's how I met you, Monica. So she invites me to come listen to your stage presentation where she was doing a panel with you. And I was like, this girl knows what she's doing. This woman has it down, because your explanation of blockchain and cryptocurrency and the state of where it is today was like normal people speak. And I was like, I want to meet her. And that's how we sort of met each other. And so
I had no idea that that was your first ever blockchain conference, because that was like one of a million for me. And I was just, so you seem like an old, first of all, you fit right in. I'll just tell you that. I had no idea you were such a newbie, or as we might think, a virgin. You were not a blockchain virgin.
I speak it really well, evidently.
Yeah. You fit right in. It was great. And yeah, I mean, I know Adrienne as well. She has brought me into so many panels. And I got to say, like, we are doing the internet right this time. I mean, women are really helping each other and really bringing each other into panels, making sure that we, even if we get into a place and we bring that gender diversity, that we're bringing other women with us. We're not going to be the only ones. And it's just, I mean, it's so important. And it's been a huge part of my process, actually. I just wrote a piece on this. I'm about to publish it, called Driven by Asterisks, meaning like every time something, a door is opened, it's mostly been someone whose name is in an asterisk. And I realized after I asterisked all of the main people in my life, in my journey with blockchain and in tech this time around, with like the internet, you know, latest 0.0, it was like, oh, every single asterisk is for another woman's name. We are really helping each other out. And when you invited me to come on, I thought, oh my gosh, this is the perfect co-hosting thing. It's another badass woman who's like bringing me another badass woman. We're like, we got to stick together on this. We got to do this.
Absolutely. But plus, I couldn't resist the idea of having it be Profit and Hazard with our double letters. Like, it just seemed like it was meant to be, because that is the kind of thing that I like to explore risks, because in risks are opportunities. And so I always do look at the hazards of product launching or the hazards of blockchain launching, whatever that is. And so I love that, you know, we have those two sides of us, because you are always looking at the investment opportunities and the money side of things. You have a lot more of experience in that. And so tell everyone about both your book, Blockchain 101, which is great, which I have used, like, I have it right behind me on the desk. I'm like, okay, let me look this up, make sure I understand this term. And so, yeah, so it's my guide. But you also you have an amazing experience and you're in fundraising mode. So
I am in fundraising mode, which is the biggest part of what I've not done before. Everything else in business, I feel like, okay, I get it. You know, how to be lean, how to be agile, how to build something, bootstrap it yourself. My last company was in the arts and culture space. I took real estate investment I had done, and I decided what I really wanted to see was more support and programming and cool things for artists to make work. So I just took what I had and I put it at what I wanted to see in the world. And that's just, I think, what most entrepreneurs are doing in one way or another is, you know, where there's somewhere on the creator to consumer spectrum. You know, I don't create sweaters, I consume them. I don't create my clothing, I don't create my textiles or my furniture. I do create other things. I used to create paintings and site-specific installations, sculpture, you know, audio pieces. I would create those things. And now I create businesses. But, you know, when you want to create something, it's very different than when you want to consume something. Like, I don't have an interest in reinventing the jeans. I like denim. What they're doing with it is fine. I'm okay.
Why mess with what works, right?
You know, it works. I'm not any smarter about that than they are. In fact, I'm going to leave that to the experts. Also, parenting, leaving it to the experts, not totally jumping in on making humans. Just not one of the creative things I'm going to do. But when it comes to things I do want to create, that's where I think the inclination of the entrepreneur and the artist are very similar and very unique. The person who is driven to create is the person who goes, I'm looking out at the world of things and none of them are good enough. I'm only going to be satisfied if I can make this thing I haven't seen yet. And that inclination is very specific. And it's really, I think it's almost sacred in a way, because not everyone has that. And when you do have it, it's usually just in a couple of certain places that you really want to have that impact and say, none of the things out here are good enough. I have to make, I'm going to only be fulfilled by making. And so in being fulfilled by making, when I opened up my lens of what a creator was, and it to include the entrepreneur, not just the artist, I realized I wanted to make things that affected more lives than just people in the creative class. So I basically, over the last few years, I just sort of shifted after 8 years of running my last company, Starry Night Programs. I sold it to another woman, a woman entrepreneur, who loves serving the creative class. And I shifted over to who's the larger class of people that I want to serve? And I realized it was people that were just like me that had wanted to get into real estate investing, that wanted to have those really solid returns, but didn't really know how to start or found it really expensive to get in and out. So I decided to start Rise Housing so I could have kind of a broader impact, but still be able to affect things like, you know, gentrifying neighborhoods where artists live. And so I just felt like it gave me the chance to have a bigger creation than a smaller creation. And I guess everybody's sort of doing that. Even if your creations are your kids, they get bigger and you're like, whoa,
that's right.
Now you're walking. It's like, whoa, now you're into college. You know, they're doing something else. You made this like, you know, fully vested tax paying entity and you just made it, you know, it's amazing.
So I have three of those. So I'm on that side of it. But you know, and one of them is wonderful. And she runs one of my companies,
but the other two are little, like
the other two are little. Yeah. So they're still budding. We're not sure where they're going to end up on the spectrum, but they seem to be very creative as well. But you know what? I agree with you, Monica, because being an originator, being an original, whether it's your original purpose, your view, your mission, or it is actually physically creating objects and things and you know, art or whatever that is, being an originator is extremely human. Like that, I feel like creation is a part of who we are. And so when I see technology supporting that, and enabling that and getting it, you know, this is where a lot of people are afraid of things like AI. And I'm not, because I think at the end of the day, it is those of us who can analyze, can interpret, can turn that into an opportunity and a creation from culling that data. That's where the power is going to lie, not in the data itself.
Right.
And so, you know, the data itself is just, mundane work that I don't need to do now. To be able to get more easily access and make my decisions and make, you know, and make the future thing that whatever that object or thing might be.
And it's funny that you leap straight from the creative impulse to AI, because I think that it's, I know that there are a lot of people that look at this as a huge threat, and I understand why, and I'm not dismissing that, but I see also this huge opportunity in that currently a lot of our economic systems have to do with human beings doing rote activity. And the more we can train a robot to do the rote things, the more we're gonna see a shift in the value system of, you know, of the person who can synthesize the most information and outdo a robot and be the most creative will be the most useful, right? Instead of the person who knows how to show up on time, get to sleep on the time, have a right schedule, act like a robot, and keep their personal life outside of work hours. You know, now it's going to be, no, what can you infuse of your unique perspective? That's where your value is. And it's going to be so interesting to watch education reform, all kinds of things really adapt to go, no, what you are, your data, your personal data, your personal signature is your best value. It's going to be a strange era for not only, I think, narcissism, but also creativity as a much broader thing, you know?
Well, and I think that this is my mission always is to, if there's something that can let me be more authentically me and give me more time to do the things that I'm amazing at, then I'm going to have a better business, right? So that's where a lot of people fail, is that we just think we have to do all of the aspects of everything that's going around us, right? Yeah. And it's so frustrating.
It's exhausting. You can't keep up. There are too many things to do.
Right. Exactly. And so being able to then stay and live in the thing that I'm brilliant at,
right,
really is the future. And when people are more like that, we're going to have faster advances and future growth. But the real interest for me in blockchain especially is that in a lot of those other areas, there's not enough women, there's not enough cultural diversity happening, and we're not getting participation at the ground floor level. And there's an opportunity to change that here with blockchain.
Oh, absolutely. I couldn't agree more. I mean, like, it is so exciting to see that not only is by the virtue of the idea and the ethics and the morals, yes, we should, you know, be including more people and more voices, makes us a healthier economy, it makes us a healthier ecology. If you just look at simply plants, you can't have if you don't have biodiversity, you have a dead field that will become a dust bowl, right? We learned that in the 30s. So, you know, over harvesting and getting too mono about anything, too homogenous, is to your own detriment. So of course that's inherent in cultural and in business and in all the other types of activities. But I think what's really beautiful is that blockchain is literally built in a way that it only flourishes if it has great diversity of inputs and great diversity of not to get too technical, but of nodes.
Right.
But the more information that's in there, the more robust it actually is. So now that we've built this technology and we're building more and more applications on top of it that truly reflects the healthiest version of our ecology, now we're finally getting some evolution in the space. And that's what's exciting to me. Not only is that there a lot of human potential for engagement, but I mean, it's just, it doesn't seem like an abstract concept that we have very evenly distributed resources in terms of human beings' capacity around the globe. There is, you know, there are all kinds of people that simply are in the wrong place. They don't have enough education or access. And therefore, we don't even get to know the resources they bring, the brilliance they have. So right. The more we diversify entry points there, the better we will all be. I can't help but, you know, sing kumbaya about that one.
So if you guys haven't guessed how passionate Monica and I are about this topic and about exploring it, let us just give you a little bit of preview on what we expect and how it's going to work. So we're going to be doing interviews with both creators, so people who are starting ventures and different blockchain and cryptocurrency companies, basically. And we're going to have some that are in applications. So maybe they've created apps, or maybe they've created a fund already, or they've started some of these different things. So they're maybe farther along on the path of some of the things you've been thinking about in the back of your minds about maybe there's an application for it here. But they're also touching on themes of opportunities. So whether it's disenfranchisement or distrust in the process, like I was referring to about supply chain problems.
Yeah.
There's a lot of distrust in that process.
Seriously.
So we're going to be highlighting some of the reasons that these blockchains will probably succeed because they're exploiting these opportunities.
Yeah, I think it also, I want to make sure that that you guys know we're going to be telling a lot of stories in this, because it's one thing to get data, but really, just like how the economy is shifting to the utility of the creative person and the new economy that really values creativity, we also, to have that data happen within a context of a story. How did you get here? Why did you think about this? Why did you come up with this idea? What was the need that you saw you're filling? And not just that you're going to go make a thing in the market, but like, what in your life, like where were you in your lifespan and your own personal story that made this interesting to you? I think that context is huge. I mean, there's a reason why there's an entire channel dedicated to documentaries and discovery. You know?
That's right.
We want to know like how did it happen.
But I also like to ask the hard questions like, you know, how did you actually get started in this? Because this is, I think, a big question is like, you say, I think I might have a good blockchain, opportunity, but like, where do I go? Where do I learn? Where do I find good resources? How do I trust them? You know, like there's a whole series of questions that this raises as you start exploring and seeing whether or not this is of value to you. And so we want to kind of represent some of those opportunities and show how people have done it and have gotten started.
And exactly. So and I mean, the thing them. Is we have so many investment opportunities now. It's going to be really interesting to just showcase some of the things that now are not closed off to average people, you know, whether it's from the innovation side or the investment side.
Right. Absolutely. So we're going to try to do that. So we're splitting our time. So you're going to get a solo interview episode with me occasionally, and then you'll get one with Monica, and then we'll try to meet together in the middle and have a conversation about what we learned from each person or what we learned that week. And so we're going to try to keep pairing you up and giving you three episodes a week if we can keep up the pace, because we're really busy. We're speaking a lot of places, but we're going to do our best to kind of give you that opportunity to see different views and then have a discussion in between of what we're learning in the process and what we're seeing as well. So we want to give you that. So we want to get you excited about blockchain. We want to get you thinking about it. We want to invite you to get involved. And we want to make sure that you feel that the involvement and getting involved is accessible to you, whether you're in the business, solopreneur, whatever that opportunity that you feel is intriguing you enough to get and listen to this podcast. We want to make sure that we show you ways in which you can get involved and can get started and can get your feet wet.
Yep, absolutely. Ditto what she said. Just what she said.
There you go. So anyway, we also would love to have feedback from you guys about what you'd like to hear, people you've sort of read about, but you'd like to hear more from.
Yeah.
So we want to invite you to converse with us, right? To get to know us. So we're on social media at New Trust Economy. We're also at newtrusteconomy.com. So you can connect with us there and just, you know, hey, make suggestions. We look forward to it. We definitely want to hear about people we may not be coming in contact with. So, you know, bring awareness to projects that you're working on and let us know about it.
Absolutely. And also, I think that there are a lot of people that are doing businesses that do not involve blockchain, but they think that there might be a good application for it. So even there, there's a lot to be talking about there to see, hey, is the blockchain right for your business? You know?
Yeah. Yeah. What's your questions? Where are you struggling? Where aren't you finding information that we want to fill that? We want to fill that void for you as well. So definitely let us know if you've got these questions going on in your head. Absolutely. So reach out to us anywhere. And we really look forward to serving you at the new trust economy for days to come.
For 3 times a week to come.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. So you can find out all about Monica and I on the website, New Trust Economy. So if you want to get some more details on where we're speaking, what we're doing, get a link to Monica's book, Blockchain 101.
Absolutely.
You can get a link to my column as well. And we've reposted some of our articles, which are out there, and we've consolidated them there. So you can also check out there to read my specific Inc. articles that are on blockchain, and Monica's articles that she's been publishing out in other areas are also reprinted or republished.
Republished
on newtrusteconomy.com for you to find.
Yep. Thank you guys so much. This is going to be so much fun. I can't wait.
We really look forward to talking with you again on the New Trust Economy.